Hey, Max here. We as software engineers and cybersecurity specialists need to understand how things around us work. And since we have AI hype now, today's topic is the theory behind basic text classification neural networks, with an example of building a spam detector in Python, almost from scratch. I'm not a mathematician, but it might be an advantage because I'll do my best to explain everything in simple terms. Let's start. Spam and phishing messages bother us almost daily, so protecting our users from such messages is quite important. Let's look at these two messages without any context. They both use similar words, share the same topic, have a sense of urgency, and contain a link. But you can clearly tell which one is spam. It is really hard to come up with some linear algorithm that can tell why one message is spam and another is not, and cover so many cases. A common solution might be to train a neural network against a specific dataset. But what is a neural network? From the outside perspective, it is just a very complex mathematical function. A function is a relation between inputs and outputs, where each input is related to a single output. In our case, the input is our message, and the output is a probability of this message to be spam, with a value in range between 0 and 1. Mathematical functions mostly work with numbers, so the next logical question may be how to represent this sentence as a set of numbers. The first idea might be to convert all the characters into their ASCII codes, but it is actually a bad idea. The goal of this network is to understand the meaning of messages, and characters don't actually convey any meaning, but words do. So we need to convert words into numbers. This is the task for a tokenizer. We can tokenize words by going through our vocabulary and giving each word a unique number, starting from 1. Also, it is worth removing non-alphabetical characters. This is actually a valid input for a neural network. But there is still another issue. The relations between words are very valuable for spam recognition, and these tokens have no relations with each other. If you saw the previous tokenized message enough times, eventually you would recognize the sequence. But what if we replace one word with a synonym? If you haven't seen this value before, you have no idea what it is. Neither neural network does. We need the numerical representation of our message to also store relations between words. So if we replaced words with synonyms, it would still make sense to a network, just as the same operation with a real message makes sense to us humans. We can use word embeddings to solve this problem. The idea of word embeddings is to represent words with vectors of numbers, where the relations between words are preserved, but represented by distances in a vector space. For this spam detector, I used pre-trained word embeddings from Stanford's Glove project. Did you hear I used the word pre-trained? It is because you can actually train embeddings as a part of a neural network. But it is quite a complicated topic, and the goal of this video is to cover basics, so it's definitely out of scope. For small neural networks, like the one we are building now, it is often recommended to use pre-trained embeddings. Large domain-specific neural networks often have to train their embeddings together with the network to achieve better results. Getting back to the relations. In this Glove project examples, you can see that distances between words, such as man and woman and king and queen, are quite similar. The same works with comparative and superlative adjectives. This is the representation of relations between words and embeddings. However, the images you see in this example use two-dimensional representations. The actual vectors Glove provides have up to 300 dimensions. I don't have a large vocabulary in the dataset, so I used 100-dimensional vectors for this project. We replace each word token with a corresponding 100-dimensional vector from pre-trained embeddings to have a very long list of numbers ready to be used as input for our network. Finally, we are ready to fully focus on the network itself. Artificial neural network is inspired by the structure and function of biological neural networks in brains. I am definitely not a specialist in brains, so I'm not going to cover their similarities and differences. Neural networks are composed of neurons, or units, where each neuron individually performs only a simple computation. The power of a neural network comes instead from the complexity of the connections these neurons can form. Each artificial neuron has inputs x and produces a single output. Every input is multiplied by its own weight w. Some inputs can be configured to affect the neuron more than the others by setting bigger weights. I'll show you an example a bit later. In addition to weights, the neuron's output is controlled by a bias, b. The bias enables the neuron to change the output independently of its inputs. All of that, summed together, is wrapped in a non-linear function, which is called an activation function. I used the sigmoid function in this example. Functions like sigmoid only output values between 0 and 1, making it useful for binary classification problems, as they can output a probability value. So, this is the complete neuron formula. The output of a neuron can be sent to multiple other neurons. The formula stays the same, just the input X is replaced with the output of another neuron, A. Neurons in a network are organized in layers. The simplest neural network has three layers, the input layer I, the hidden layer H, and the output layer O. The number of units N in each layer might be different, but it is usually smaller in every next layer. The longest message in our dataset contains 23 words. As I told you before, each word is represented by a 100-dimensional vector, so we need 2,300 input neurons. The number of neurons in the output layer depends on the task. For example, if we wanted to classify handwritten numbers into 10 categories, we would need 10 neurons in the output layer. For our project, we want to classify messages into only 2 categories, so a single output neuron is enough. Values closer to 0 represent ham messages, and values closer to 1 represent spam messages. The number of neurons in the hidden layer often requires testing. A logical question for the default value might be, how many patterns do you want the network to recognize in the input data? But it is really hard to answer that, so it's often just trials and errors. I chose 128 neurons in the hidden layer, and to be honest, I just came up with this number based on my experience, and it worked. I cannot give any scientific data behind this decision. The neural network structure should be clear now. But when I write all the indices of this network, they look terrifying. Let's unwrap them layer by layer. Again, X is the input. There is no need to calculate it, it is just given. Everything that belongs to the input layer is marked by a superscript I. It is not power, it is yet another label. So Ni is the number of neurons in the input layer. A superscript H is used for the hidden layer, so Nh is the number of neurons in the hidden layer. And WJIH, again, denotes the weight for the connection between the input and the hidden layer neurons. Small I here denotes the index of the input layer neuron, and J denotes the index of a neuron in the hidden layer. The indices J and I might feel backward, but they line up with how you execute matrix multiplications. Don't pay too much attention to matrices now. I'll try to omit them as much as possible in this video for simplicity. You will understand matrix usages better when you look at the code of the practical example. Now, the same idea is applied to the output layer O, but it has lesser indices, because it comprises a single output neuron. Let's write down all the formulas to calculate neuron values at each level. Make sure you pause here for some time and fully understand the notations. A great question may appear in your mind. Why do we need an activation function? Activation functions are necessary to prevent linearity. A neuron function without activation is a linear function. The composition of linear functions is also a linear function. So no matter how many layers of neurons the data goes through, they all can be replaced by a single linear function. The nonlinearity is critical because without it, you can't approximate nonlinear functions well. Imagine a children's drawing book where you need to connect all the dots to get a picture of a cat, but you can only draw a single straight line somewhere through the middle of the picture. Getting back to our network. The process of passing input data through the whole network, applying weights and biases, and computing the final output is called forward propagation. However, the output of a neural network doesn't make any sense until the network is trained. Training the network is just setting weights and biases in such a way that the output of the whole network satisfies our needs for the most of the input samples. The method that trains the network is called backpropagation. The main idea of this algorithm is to compare the current output of the network with the expected output, calculate the error E, the deviation between expected and actual outputs, and slightly change weights and biases in the direction that gives the biggest decrease of the error. Mathematically, it is built upon the idea of the gradient descent. Yep, it's all derivatives. But before jumping to derivatives, let me explain the overall concept of training without formulas. Suppose you had to train the network manually. In that case, you would try to configure the hidden layer neurons to recognize some patterns, and then configure the neurons of the output layer to decide how the presence or absence of each pattern affects the output. This can be done by adjusting the weights and biases. For example, I would probably try to adjust weights and biases so one neuron in the hidden layer was responsible for recognizing urgency somewhere in the middle of the message, and another one for recognizing any words like cheap, affordable, and so on. The weights on the connections from these two neurons to the output neuron should also be significant enough to increase the probability of this message being spam. On the other hand, the connections from neurons that recognize things like polite forms and questions should probably have negative weights to reduce the probability of the message being spam when they are activated. This is an exaggerated example, but you get the idea. As you might have noticed, it is very hard to come up with all the required patterns and almost impossible to tweak weights and biases correctly. So the goal of backpropagation is to make the network come up with these patterns during learning based on the deviation of the output and tweak weights and biases to achieve better results. Let's start from the beginning. Say we have a simple function y equals minus x squared plus 2x. Let's draw its graph and pick a single point on it. You can clearly see that if you increase the input, which means moving the point in the right direction along the graph, the output also increases. If you move it to the left, it decreases. The derivative is a mathematical concept for this exact thing. It answers how much the output increases or decreases if we take an extremely small step in the right direction. I promised not to go very deep into mathematics, so you can just believe me. But if you want more, I have prepared an article about the basics of calculus with better explanations and proofs. The link is in the description. This derivative works well not only with a function of a single variable. If we had a function of multiple variables, two for this example, we could take a partial derivative to answer the question about how the independent increase of each input variable increases the output. It is called calculating a derivative of a function with respect to some variable. Applying the same principle, if we calculate how each weight and bias increase affects the deviation between the actual and the expected output, thus calculating the derivative of an error with respect to a weight or a bias, we will know whether to increase or decrease a weight or a bias and by how much. Since our goal is to decrease the error, we need to negate the result of this derivative. Also, we want to go slow and precise, so it is better to multiply this thing by a small coefficient, which is called the learning rate. This thing is pronounced as eta, by the way. Now we can use these formulas to calculate the new value for each weight and bias. Also, let's not forget that all of this is just for a single sample, thus a single message. And network training requires a large dataset of different samples. So we need to repeat the same calculations for all of the samples and use the average result. And that's the whole concept. It is really hard to meaningfully visualize these derivatives because it is far beyond three dimensions we live in. But it still works. Now, to the calculations. Let's check the formulas of forward propagation again. I want to make one adjustment. For simplicity of later derivative calculations, I want to move the linear formula of a neuron to a separate notation and call it z. So now every neuron has to calculate z and then a. The formulas are the same, I just split them. The mean squared error is commonly used as the error function. Y hat here denotes the expected output. To calculate the derivative of this error function with respect to some random weight, we need to calculate partial derivatives of all components that depend on this weight and multiply them. This is called the chain rule of derivatives. I can better explain it visually. For example, let's take this weight with indices 2 and 1. z1 of a hidden layer depends on the weight, so let's write down the derivative of z1 with respect to this weight. Then, a1 of the hidden layer depends on z1. So we need to write down the derivative of a1 with respect to z1. Then, z of the output layer with respect to a1 of the hidden layer. Then, a with respect to z. And finally, the derivative of the error with respect to the output neuron's value. I hope you got the idea, even if the resulting formula still looks a bit scary. Exactly the same idea is applied to biases and weights in other layers. Then, you do quite simple calculations using derivative formulas and reuse the results of some of these calculations because you clearly see that some of the formulas repeat, and you end up with everything you need for the project. I wrote down all these equations in a simple Python code, trained this network for many hours on a dataset of 2,500 spam and 2,500 ham messages, and got around 97% accuracy on the validation set. Remember that your network can achieve decent results only if your dataset has enough training samples for the specific task. Getting back to the first spam message example of this video. The dataset doesn't contain these specific examples, but the network correctly classifies the first message as ham and the second message as spam. If you look through the classification mistakes on the validation set, you notice that there are no false negatives or false positives. The network is just not sure enough to classify some examples. If you play with the threshold of what to consider a successful classification and maybe train the network a bit longer, you may get even better results. So, thanks a lot for watching. I hope this topic is a bit more clear to you now. I encourage you to work on your own projects as I did for this video. Again, links to my math articles and the source code are in the description. Best luck.